हेलो। हेलो
हेलो,
या गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
या दिस इज डॉक्टर कलमकर, डायरेक्टर एआरसी फ्रॉम सरदार पटेल यूनिवर्सिटी वल्लभ विद्यानगर आनंद गुजरात। And I welcome Dr. Jaspal Singh ji, Niti Aayog, New Delhi.
हेलो,
गुड मॉर्निंग डॉक्टर जसपाल सिंह जी।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग डॉक्टर कलमकर, हाउ आर यू?
आई एम वेरी नाइस टू बी विथ यू इन दिस टेक्निकल सेशन।
थैंक यू सर। आई आर आल्सो, इट्स लॉट्स ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर मी टू जॉइन यू।
Yeah, it's so nice. And Dr. Hemant Sharma is with us, the faculty from AERC, Sardar Patel University, our own university. He has joined with us.
Good morning, all of you. And I'm Dr. Hemant Sharma. Good morning, Jaspal sir.
Very good morning, Hemant. How are you?
Fine, sir.
Good.
I welcome all other paper presenters and participants in this technical session 6. Now we need to start with, we have 11 paper on the board. 1, 2, 3. 11 paper on the board. Can we take just how many are there at present with us? I think we have Amit Kumar. I could see him. Dr. Amit?
Yes, sir. I'm here.
Yeah. And can anyone say, let us know who is there among the paper presenters? Hello?
Sir, I'm Amit Kumar. I'm here for presentation.
Yes.
Sir, can we start our session?
Yeah, we are starting our session now with kind of permission with our co-chairman, Dr. Jaspal Singh, and my co-colleague, rapporteur from Dr. Sharma.
That's why I think 6-7 presenters are here. I think Diksha Sethi, Kanika Mehta, Shruti Mishra, Shekhar, and Banan 2 are all there. Hello,
Hemant.
Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Please go ahead, Dr. Kalimkar. Go ahead.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. And Dr. Sharma, you please take a note of a proceeding.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and we will start with the presentation number NS 20063. The paper on chemical control measures adopted by the Kinno Growers in Punjab. Author by Amit Kumar and Pankaj Kumar. Yes, please start, Dr. Amit Kumar.
Okay. Good morning, sir.
Please, one minute. I request to all the participants, please mute your
mic.
And please, a minimum, like a standardized time. Maximum 10 minutes, I think.
Yes, sir.
Please not take too much time because our presenter are here, most of the persons. And after every presentation, just 1 and 2 minutes to allow you to all the presenters to any technical questions. Hai na?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Okay. Good morning, sir.
Start, Dr. Amit.
I'm Amit Kumar, and from Punjab Agricultural University, Ludhiana. And today is my topic of webinar is chemical control measures adopted by Kinno growers in Punjab. And first of all, introduce about the topic. Horticulture crops form a significant part of the total agriculture produce of our country. Kinno, which occupies a prime position among citrus fruit grown in India, can be utilized for processing into medicinal products, a variety of beverages, and industrial uses due to its flavor, attractive color, and rich source of vitamins and minerals. Under Punjab condition, Kinu has maintained a major commercial significance with total production of fruits in 2014-15 was 1108.62 million tons from an area of 48.18 thousand hectares, which rose to 1246.8 million tons in 2018-19, with an increase in area of 53.05 thousand hectares in the state. Several types of insect pests and diseases damage the foliage and reduce the yield and quality of the fruit. A few insect pest diseases attack the kinu produce are Citrusilla, aphid, leaf miner, citrus canker, foot rot, and citrus cap. The study was conducted to find out various plant protection measures being adopted by kinu growers in kinu cultivation. And the methodology for the studies, the study was conducted in Fazilka district of Punjab state because the number of kinu growers was maximum in this district. And a list of kinu growers was obtained from the concerned horticulture development officer of Horticulture Department Punjab. From this list, 120 kinu growers were selected according to probability proportion to number of kinu growers from different blocks. The plant protection measures being followed in kinu cultivation was selected as dependent variable, and among independent variables are age, education, operational land holding, experience of kinu cultivation, yield per acre, size of kinu, annual income, extension contacts, and mass media exposure were selected. The data were collected by personally interviewing the respondents with the help of interview schedule, and the data collected were tabulated and analyzed with the help of proper statistical tool like frequency, percentage, and range method. For result and discussion, first of all, socioeconomic characters of the respondents, and about 50% of the respondents belong to middle age group, that is 38 to 54 years, and about 33% of the respondents were educated up to graduation. And about 35% of the respondents had medium level of operational land holding. Among the experience of kinu cultivation, about 56% of the respondents had experience of 10 to 19 years experience in kinu cultivation. And about 43% of the respondents obtained yield of kinu per acre of 114 to 168 quintals per acre. And about 63% of the respondents obtained 10 to 14 rupees per kg for their kinu produce. And among total income from kinu orchards, about 56% of the respondents obtained 1,10,000 to 1,80,000 rupees per acre income. And from the level of extension contacts, about 50% of the respondents had medium level of extension contacts for obtaining information about kinu cultivation. And from the mass media exposure, about 40% of the respondents had medium level of mass media exposure for obtaining information about kinu cultivation. Next, distribution of respondents according to different plant protection measures being followed for insect pest management in kinu cultivation. The Citrusilla is major insect in kinu cultivation, and for the control of this, about 59% of the respondents applied recommended insecticides, and about 59% of the respondents followed recommended time of application for the recommended insecticide application, and about 25% of the respondents applied recommended doses for the recommended insecticide. For the control of aphid, about 66% of the respondents applied recommended insecticide, about 64% of the respondents applied recommended insecticide at recommended time interval, and about 29% of the respondents applied recommended doses. For control of leaf miner, about 57% of the respondents applied recommended insecticides, and about 57% of the respondents applied recommended insecticide at recommended time interval. About 31% of the respondents applied recommended doses of the particular insecticide. For control of mealybug, about 27% of the respondents applied recommended insecticide, and 27% of the respondents applied recommended insecticide at recommended time interval, and only about 27% of the respondents applied recommended doses for the recommended insecticide. for control of whitefly in quinoa cultivation. About 58% of the respondents applied recommended insecticide. About 56% of the respondents applied recommended insecticide at recommended time interval. And about 41% of the respondents applied recommended doses for the recommended insecticides. For control of thrips, about 38% of the respondents applied recommended insecticides. About 25% of the respondents applied recommended time of application. And about 32% of the respondents applied recommended dose for the particular insecticide, recommended insecticide. For control of mites in quinoa cultivation, about 57% of the respondents applied recommended insecticide. And 57% of the respondents applied recommended insecticide at recommended time interval. And about 46% of the respondents applied recommended dose for the mite. Next is distribution of respondents according to use of dose for recommended insecticide for insect pest management. For control of Citrusilla, Actara and Confidor were recommended insecticides. And about 48% of the respondents applied recommended dose for Advil, and about 21% of the respondents applied recommended dose for Confidor application. And for control of aphid, same Actara and Confidor were recommended insecticides, and about 43% of the respondents applied recommended doses. And for Confidor, about 50% of the respondents applied recommended doses. For control of leaf miner, Actara and Confidor are again recommended insecticide. For Confidor application, about 52% of the respondents applied recommended doses. And for Actara application, about 66% of the respondents applied recommended doses. For control of whitefly, post mite is recommended, and about 70% of the respondents applied recommended doses. For mite, post mite is again recommended insecticide, and about 81% of the respondents applied recommended doses. For thrips, post mite is again recommended insecticide, and 83% of the respondents applied recommended doses. For control of mealybug, chloroben or chloropyrifos is recommended, and all the respondents applied recommended doses. Next is recommended distribution of respondents according to plant protection measures followed for disease management. The major disease faced by quinoa growers were citrus canker and gamosis or foot rot. For control of citrus canker, about 97% of the respondents applied recommended pesticides. About 65% of the respondents applied recommended pesticide at recommended time interval. And about 66% of the respondents applied recommended doses. For control of gamosis or foot rot, about 89.36% of the respondents applied recommended pesticides. And about 89% of the respondents applied recommended pesticide at recommended time interval. And about 74% of the respondents applied recommended doses for particular disease. Among recommended pesticides, that is distribution of respondents according to dose of recommended pesticide used for disease management. And for citrus canker management, streptocycline plus copper sulfate is recommended, and Bodex mixture is recommended. For streptocycline and copper sulfate, about 63% of the respondents applied recommended doses. And for Bodex mixture application, about 80% of the respondents applied recommended doses. For control of gamosis or foot rot, it is also a major disease in quinoa cultivation. And for that, Redomil Gold is recommended, and about 56% of the respondents applied recommended doses. For Elliott application, about all the respondents applied recommended doses. For sodium hypochlorite application, it is more popular nowadays, and all the respondents applied recommended doses. And for Bodex mixture application, all the respondents applied recommended doses. Next is distribution of respondents according to weed management in quinoa orchards. And for weed management, majority of respondents followed hand hoeing, that is 95% of the respondents. Mechanical weeding also followed by 95% of the respondents. Only a few quinoa growers adopt chemical method to control weed management in cannabis cultivation, and that is 10.83%. And recommended chemical was used by all the respondents, and recommended time of adoption application was followed by 8.33% respondents, and recommended dose was followed by 7.50% of the respondents.
Next, Amiji, you can summarize because 11 minutes are over.
Okay, sir. Conclusion, that is risk of insect pest and disease attack on kinu orchard. For management of different pest, chemical control method were most prevalent among kinu growers. However, as far as the management of weeds were concerned, non-chemical methods were more popular among kinu growers. Although most of the times kinu growers were using recommended pesticide and weedicide, but a considerable deviation from recommended dose and time of application was there. So for the better management of pests and weeds, they should be trained, motivated to adopt recommended chemicals, doses, and time of application. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you, Amit. This is about the chemical control measure adopted by the kinu growers in Punjab.
Yes.
So we can open it for the question and answer if somebody wants to have.
Okay, sir.
Amit?
Yes, sir.
You present in the first slide in your introduction, please.
Yes, sir.
You wrote here about production about 1108.62 million ton of kinu.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No, this is, I think, joint tissue. India produce about 294 million ton of fruits and vegetables both. How it is possible? Please recheck it.
Okay, sir. I will.
I think this is 1,000 ton.
I think metric ton.
Yeah.
Metric ton.
Please recheck it.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, anyone?
Yeah, anyone other?
Okay, Dr. Kalmekar?
Yes, sir.
Call to next one. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, sir. So thank you, Mr. Amit Kumar, for your brief presentation on this. So may I invite another one, the next one in the sequence, if available with us, NS 20064, Amandeep Singh and Dharminder Singh. Problem and prospect of vegetable cultivation in Sangrampur district of Punjab.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Please introduce yourself.
Sir, myself, Amandeep Singh. And I have studied from Punjab Agricultural University, Ludhiana. And
okay.
I completed my MSc in 2019,
okay.
Sorry, sir. And now I present my paper and I share you. Please wait, sir.
Mr. Amandeep?
Yes, sir.
You can share your screen.
Yes, sir. Please wait.
Yeah. No, it is your mark sheet.
I think.
Amandeep ji.
Yeah, I think he is share from their phone.
Sorry, sir, by the way, I can upload.
Oh, yeah, this is.
So, congratulations.
I think COVID teach us all of us lots of things how to use this multimedia and all.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Very true. Very true.
Yeah. Yeah.
Good morning, sir.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Budak, sir. Welcome, sir.
Yes, Samandi.
Yes, sir, please. I think I PPT is on my mail, sir, but I can't find.
Can we go to next? Then by the time you can get ready.
Yeah, we go to next. You, yes. Saman, you find that your PPT and
Do we have a next speaker? NS20065. Sukhdev Singh Sadhu and Jasdeep Singh Tur. Sukhdev Singh Sadhu and Jasdeep Singh Tur.
Sir, I find this and I also share. Please check.
Yeah. Okay, you share, Amandeep.
Yeah.
ਤੁਸੀਂ 2 ਮਿੰਟ ਵੇਟ ਕਰ ਲਓ ਮੈਡਮ ਮੇਰਾ ਚੱਲ ਜਾਏਗਾ ਕਾਉਂਸਲਿੰਗ ਤੂੰ ਬਿਠਾ ਲਾ ਉੱਥੇ ਦੇਖ ਲੈ ਖੋਲ ਕੇ ਦੇਖ ਲੈ
No, your topic is problem is prospect of vegetable cultivation.
This is different one, yeah.
Amandeep. Go to next if you have.
Can you hello?
We can move next. Amandeep, can you hear us? Amandeep?
Yes sir, what I can't see you.
Amandeep, agar nahi mil raha to next ko hum allow kar de.
Sir, haan ji allow kar do, koi baat nahi, main next de leta hu, but mujhe ab dekh nahi rahe.
Sukhdev Singh Sandhu is there. I think Sukhdev Singh is also not there.
Okay, sir. Next we can invite Mahima Gabru. Diksha Sethi ji is there, I think.
Yes, sir.
Madam Diksha, can you please start your presentation?
Yes, sir.
Please. You please share the screen.
Sir, I can't share because someone else is sharing the screen.
Amanji.
Anji, sir.
You leave out the screen.
Okay, sir.
Sir, shall I start?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. Amandeep.
Aman,
please.
Yes, sir.
Mute your mic.
Okay.
Yeah. Please go.
So a very good morning to all present. Today, I, Diksha Sethi, would like to present my webinar on the topic R&D investment and agricultural development view. So the authors for the same are Mahima Ji Ghabru, Diksha Sethi and Dr. K.D. Sharma. So starting with the introduction, as we all know that India is predominantly an agrarian economy where more than 69% of the population resides in rural areas and 47% of the workforce is engaged in agriculture. The Indian economist and Nobel laureate Amartya Sen emphasized that food security is not only a matter of producing enough food to eat, but also of making the food available to those who actually need it. So India undoubtedly is on a remarkable development path with the hunger solution like Green Revolution, NFSM, which drive growth and socio-economic progress. Yet it is a home for 23% of the chronically undernourished population as it ranks 102 out of 117 countries in Global Hunger Index. Though the solution seems simple, but it has its own share of setbacks like deteriorating natural resource base, then declining total factor productivity, climate change, and inadequate investment on research and development. Many studies show that agriculture productivity can effectively be the first step towards growth and greater income for a country. Public spendings on agriculture is one of the key policy instruments of the government to promote growth and alleviate poverty in the rural areas. Apart from various other spendings by the government on agriculture, the most integral investment is on agriculture research and education, various innovations and techniques that eventually enhance the agriculture productivity. In a book named Supporting Indian Farms, The Smart Way put forth that every rupee invested on agriculture research and development yields better return, that is 11.2, as compared to the every rupee spent on fertilizer subsidy, which return with return of 0.88, power 0.79, and other. Successful innovation in agriculture depends on new technology that are well targeted, which in turn depends on efficient agriculture research system, appropriate capacity and infrastructure. So increased research and development investment offers possibility to enhance quality and quantity of agricultural output with increased income source, greater food security and better nutrition. The growth of agriculture sector can be inclusive if accompanied by improvements on other sectors as well, like improved research infrastructure, better management of agricultural resources, rural empowerment, and creating more income generation opportunities. Coming to the results, so firstly, we'll discuss about the structure of public research system. So India, as we all know, that India has one of the largest and most well-coordinated agriculture research system. So ICR is the apex institute under a National Agriculture Research System with various institutes at state level and central level. So in 2019, ICR had 65 institutions, 13 research projects, project directorates, 6 national bureaus, 64 state agriculture universities, 4 deemed universities, and 60 AICRPs, that is All India Coordinated Research Projects, which act as the bridge between ICAR and state universities. There is also another institute that is NAM under ICAR, which conduct training and research programs. Also, the ICAR ensures that all the innovation reach at the grassroots level. For that, it has a network of 716 KVKs at the district level. So in table number one, we can see that on an average, the number of agriculture researchers hovered around 12,000 to 13,000 over the time period of 2000 to 2014. And there is a decline in the number of agriculture researchers from 2000 to 2009 at the ICAR and other institutes level also, as because of the less recruitments during this time, and also the establishment of number of specialized universities pursuing to animal sciences, research on animal sciences, together with the intensification of recruitment efforts of the ICAR, the number of agriculture researchers began to rise after 2009. So next, we see that agriculture research doubled from 2000 to 2014. That is 28,768 rupees to 48,869 rupees, but still the share of agriculture research as a share of agriculture GDP is low, decreasing from 0.34% to 0.30%, which is lower than many of the developed countries and is comparable to the developing countries. So it is really high in Brazil, 1.8%, followed by Mexico, 1.05%. Being home for such a teeming population, the impetus of research and development spending was on developing high-yielding variety seeds that enhance the production and productivity. So undoubtedly, crop husbandry is integral, but other sectors cannot, like fisheries, forestry, livestock, etc., which can be seen from figure number one. And then we can see this table is taken from the study conducted by Sharma, Chauhan and Sharma in 2011 at CSK HPKV Palampur. In this, we can see that the new varieties since 2003 and 4 had produced incremental benefit worth rupees 1335 lakh on with just an welfare of worth rupees 222 crore had been gained from milk production through rupees 157 crore of research and development investment, which demonstrates the contribution of R&D infrastructure in raising the production of economic welfare in dairy sector. So coming to the conclusion, given the food resource restriction, investing on agriculture research is the only source of enhancing the productivity of input. India has over the years increased its spending on research and development, but still comparatively a lot needs to be done. And India's research intensity ratio relative to agriculture GDP to be low in comparison to other countries. So the aid network of National Agriculture Research System, that is NARS, is dedicated towards ensuring better and efficient research and also improving the coordination of programs among various institutes. The desired result of investment on research and development can only be achieved if concerted efforts are also made towards linking the farming community or ensuring the dissemination of the innovation at the grassroots level. Though impetus on agriculture research and development is important, but alongside improving research infrastructure, adequate management of natural resources, better marketing and credit facilities, rural empowerment, and creating more income generation opportunities is equally integral. These are the references. Thank you.
Thank you, Diksha Sethi, being very accurately in the time of your presentation.
Thanks.
Yeah, can any question is there? I have one question, but I will ask in the last. Okay. Anyone has a question to ask her?
Yeah, Diksha. I have 2-3 doubts. Okay. First of all, you present a number of tables, but I don't find any table which you compiled yourself in your research. You collect it as it is from another studies.
Yes, so it is actually a review paper, so I've collected from
in review paper also.
Yes, sir.
You don't compiled any one from yourself. And one thing,
yes sir,
in your whole paper, you not present anywhere the difference of Indian expenditure with the world level, with the other countries. But in your conclusion, you wrote there, the Indian expenditure system on agriculture research is comparatively or less than the other nations.
Yes.
But how we conclude this without any comparison in our paper? Please.
Sir, actually,
about it in your future research.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. This is just suggestion for you and to improve your research. This is not criticism of your research, okay. But be careful about such things. Yeah.
Madam, this Shetty. Yeah, it is a right term actually to look into how much expenditure goes into the agriculture research and education, as we have the huge network of ICAR, SAUs, KVK, and others.
Yes, sir.
Now the table which you have put, you need to compile some data, though it is a review. You can compile and prepare the table on your own. For example, agriculture research and education, there is a plan, a non-plan scheme of a state governments. And there are some of the schemes which support the education through the like RPVY and others. I think you, if you put this plan-wise expenditure by these agencies, then you are going to make a very concrete idea how much expenditure really is going to be poor by these three things. Because if you ask me, it was 6,800 crores as per the economic survey in 2018. Government has poured the money from center government, but there are the contribution support by the state governments also. And some schemes also provide the money, as I mentioned, like RPVY. So you make the holistic whole things together to look into how much money has been poured to create the human resource in the agriculture sector.
Okay, sir.
Because you have not touched about how many students are enrolled, how many are passed out, or some of the other aspects are also there, which adds to the nation for creating the agriculture favorable environment.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. It was nice. Well, yeah, in time.
This is a very interesting area. Please be carefully, and if you establish the relationship between public expenditure on agriculture and the economic growth or agriculture growth of the economy, then it's very useful. Yeah.
Yeah, please continue, and we look forward to have a very insightful paper in the next some nearby conference or webinar. May I invite the next speaker if we are available with us, Kanika Mehta. I could see her. Yeah, can you please start, Ms. Kanika Mehta, with Rajesh Kumar Thakur and J.S. Guleria, having a paper on constraint in adoption of vegetable conservation hill areas of Himachal Pradesh. Madam Kanika Mehta, please.
Sir, is my screen visible?
Yeah.
Yes.
Good morning, everyone. I am Kanika Mehta.
Please start.
Good morning, everyone. I am Kanika Mehta, and I am a PhD scholar in the Department of Agricultural Economics, CSKHPKP, Palampur. I am here to discuss about the constraints in the top of protected cultivation in mid-hill areas of Himachal Pradesh. So starting with the introduction, Himachal Pradesh, as we all know, is a northwestern Himalayan state and has been serving as a potential off-season vegetable hub for production of quality vegetables. In fact, the area and production under vegetable cultivation in the state has significantly increased by about 59 and 82% over the last decade. But the state is subjected to various constraints like small and marginal land holdings, where about 87% of the farmers are small and marginal. And also the state is subjected
to... Heman, please mute your speaker. Yeah.
And the state is also subjected to various agroclimatic conditions, which are very extreme in variations. Therefore, in considering the constraints, the protected cultivation has emerged as a very promising and an important technology to ensure high productivity, lucrative returns, and employment generation. So presently, under the scheme of Dr. Y.S. Parmar, Kisan Swarojgar Yojana, the farmers are being given 85% of the subsidy for the construction of polyhouses. Also, for the use of water sources, 50% of the subsidy is being provided by the state. Protected cultivation is very important for the state, but still, considering very high investments by the government for the promotion of the cultivation, the technology is still at a very nascent stage in the state, as only about 260 hectares of area has been brought under cultivation till now. Therefore, it is very important to delineate the capital investment pattern, income generation, and constraints faced by the farmers in the protected technology. The study will be helpful to ascertain the determinants which will play significant role in the production, in the adoption of technology, and in devising strategies to overcome the challenges and its further expansion. So the objective of the study was to delineate the capital investment pattern, income generation, and constraints faced by the farmers in the adoption of technology in the state. So talking about the methodology, the study was conducted in the Kangra district of the state, as it is a very important district, as it is having very high area in terms of cultivated area in the state. By the farmers, carrot ranking technique was used. So talking about the results and discussions, first of all, I'm going to discuss about the capital investment pattern on the sample poly houses. The total, on an overall basis, the total capital investment per farm under protected cultivation was about 2,29,438 rupees, out of which approximately 81% of the contribution of the capital investment was for the construction of poly house structure, and about 14% of the expenditure was on the water tank or water sources creation, and remaining for the others like spray pump, insect pest traps, picking and transportation, etc. Considering the grower share in the total in capital investment pattern, about 28% of the investment was done by the farmers in the state. Here I would like to specify that the farmers are being provided subsidy of about 70-85%, considering the previous scheme, which was Pandit Deen Dayal Kisan Bagwan Samriddhi Yojana. Talking about the contribution of protected cultivation in the gross farm income of sample farmers, so the total average farm income annually received by the protected cultivated growers was about 2,51,000 rupees, and the large farmers were earning more, approximately 3 lakh rupees, as comparable to the small farmers, approximately 2 lakh rupees per farm. Here we can significantly see, we can see that protected cultivation is significantly increasing the income, gross farm income of the farmers by about 25% on an overall basis, and in case of large farmers, it is contributing to 30% of the gross farm income, and in the small category, it is contributing to about 18% of the gross farm income. The tomato cultivation in the protected technology is in the state is being used, as about 57% of the contribution is to tomato cultivation in the state. So talking about the operational constraints perceived by the farmers in the adoption of protected technology, using the Garrett ranking score, the problems and constraints were divided into three categories, that is high, medium, and low category of the severity level. So talking about the lack of the first and the most severe problem of the protected growers was the lack of technical know-how and training. Even though the state is providing a lot of extension services to the farmers, still the farmers complained that the technological know-how was not available to them. And as we can see that because of the lack of technological know-how, the farmers are subsequently facing the rest of the problem. That is the problem of disease and pest, like improper training, pruning, wrong varieties of crops, inadequate size of bed, wrong spacing, etc. So in order to have a further in-depth analysis of the extent of training acquired by the polyhouse growers, the farmers were asked about the extent of training provided to them. So about 90% of the sample farmers had acquired this training under protected cultivation, but most of the farmers, 70% of the farmers, had acquired only one training, and only about 3% of the farmers had taken three or more trainings in the protected cultivation, which significantly shows that the farmers need to be more updated and regular trainings are required to them. Surprisingly, about 78% of the farmers reported that they have gained the training after the installation of the protected constructions. Because of this, the farmers were unaware about the orientation, material, site selection, etc., and therefore they were at loss. And if you look at the impact of training by the farmers, so mostly farmers, 44% of the farmers have reported moderate impact of training to them, and only about 11% have reported it as a very good training. Talking about the structural or construction constraints as perceived by the farmers in the adoption of technology. So because, as we have seen in the previous slide, that the farmers are attaining the training after the installation of the poly houses. So therefore, the farmers are not having any knowledge about the site, orientation, material, and it is reported to be as the first and the foremost, most important constraint, structural constraint by the farmers. So a wrong orientation with respect to wind and sunlight and wind, doors not as per the recommendation, inappropriate quality of cladding material, etc., have been reported by the farmers. Talking about the infrastructural constraints perceived by the farmers, so the first and the foremost constraint reported by the farmers was the problem of repair or spare parts. The farmers reported that if the polyhouse structure gets destroyed because of wind or etc., the farmers are not able to assess an appropriate source for the selection of appropriate material or repair parts for the polyhouses, consequently following the lack of skilled labor, unavailability of improved variety seed, lack of irrigation water, problem of transportation, non-availability of inputs, lack of regular power supply. Talking about the institutional constraints faced by the farmers, so farmers have reported to have an inadequate extension and advisory services. Frequent services are not provided to the farmers. Lack of insurance facilities for the polyhouse structures. Improper guidance and updated guidance or frequent visits from the block officers. Non-availability of credit at time when required, and long period for approval or sanctions of their applications. Talking about the marketing constraints perceived by the farmers, lack of storage facility was reported to be of the highest severity level, followed by the price fluctuations, lack of transport facility, absence of assured marketing at remunerative prices and insurance facility, and manipulation by the merchant. Talking about the conclusion and suggestions, as we have discussed, that the transfer of protected cultivation in the state has started from 2003 and 4. Till now, the state government and the central government has provided a lot of investments and subsidies for the farmers. Still the technology is at a very nascent stage in the state. The farmers have reported to confront structural, construction, infrastructure, operation, institutional, marketing constraints in the adoption of protected technology. And most of the farmers have complained the absence of insurance facilities in case of the damage of polyhouses, improper guidance from block offices, and the non-availability of credit at time. All these services need to be improved for making any farmer-oriented project a success. Most of the polyhouse growers got their trainings after the installation of the polyhouses. Therefore, frequent and updated trainings are to be provided to the farmers. There is a dire need for the development of effective storage and marketing infrastructure, quality supply of quality planting inputs at affordable prices, effective pricing policy, frequent and effective trainings to the farmers, as well as an efficient integration of this technology by the farmers. This will not only help in enhancing the profitability and sustainability, but will also expand the adoption of technology in the state. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Kanika. So it is open for the questions. I I request respected participants, please mute the phone if they are not asking the question. Hello? Any question from the participants? Kanika, I have one or two questions.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it is a good study on the Pauli houses, protected cultivation in the Himachal Pradesh. I was very surprised to see as the training was provided to maximum number of the people, but it was provided after the installation, as you very clearly mentioned about they have a loss of selection of sites, selection of material, and these things. And that's a nice outcome of your study, which need to be sent to the concerned authority for their perusal and the correction in the implementation of the scheme. Whether any impact could you see, means while discussing with them? Somebody's phone is on. Hello? Audio is on, I think. About the GST, any impact of GST was seen in terms of total amount?
Yes, sir.
Any impact could you see total amount of subsidy or the payment to be made by the farmer?
Sir, I'm not aware of it, sir. Sorry.
Okay.
Kanika,
Dr. Yashpal Singh, sir.
Yeah. Kanika, you present very good study, but I have 2-3 questions. One thing, you compare your results of income from the protected cultivation with the field crop, livestock and all.
Yes.
But next time you compare same crop with the protected cultivated area and without cultivated protected cultivated area. That's I think more provide the more better result than this, because you seen with same set of structure two different crop provided different returns, right? Okay, if you compare, suppose capsicum with the capsicum without any protection, what is the difference between their yield, their income, their cost of cultivation? I think that's more better. And one thing more, you collect your data only from one district.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Collect your data from scattered throughout the Himachal Pradesh. That's provide you a better result than one place. Okay. Yeah, you present a good study. Good.
Yeah, good. Thank you, Ms. Kanika Mehta. So, Mr. Amandeep is around. He can get back on the presentation screen. If not, Kuldeep Kaur?
Yes, sir. Hello?
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 Ah, Kuldeep Kaur?
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning. Can you present your paper?
Yes, sir. So how to share?
Then,
yes, sir.
Mute your Mac and
yes,
your
sir. I'm doing, sir.
Yeah, slide. Yeah.
Yes, sir. I'm
okay. Share your screen.
Yes, of course. Sir, is it visible?
Double click to enter the full screen mode.
Okay, sure, sir.
Yeah, it is come.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Okay, good morning. to all present, myself Kuldeep Kaur, and my topic of the presentation is the impact of water on key health and social outcomes, the evidence from the developed and developing countries. These are the outlines of the presentation. I have started from the introduction, review of literature, then objective, research methodology and the result and discussions, and after that conclusion. As we can see from the introduction that the universal access to safe drinking water and sanitation is one of the 17 sustainable development goals. As many as 1.1 billion people in the world are still living without the adequate access to safe water. And more than 844 million people are still living without the adequate availability of basic water services in the developing countries. Due to the rapid growth of populations with the change in the climate conditions and dietary changes led to increase the demand for safe drinking water. In the developing countries, population generally have poor ranking on the Human Development Index as compared to those of the developed ones. And this is the few studies. When we see the review of literature, these are the few studies conducted by the different scholars on the concerned topic. As in 1984, the Grover highlighted that the half of the population in less developing countries does not have adequate supplies of water. Same as in 1993, Reddy and Rathore stated that distribution of drinking water is more favorable for the rich peoples in urban areas as compared to the rural areas. Nair in 1997 made an attempt to analyze the relationship between availability of safe drinking water supply and mortality rate. O'Reilly argued that water supply and sanitation provisions are key elements in progress of women participation. Similar kind of the result found by the Begum and others in 2011 that higher access to improved drinking water sources and improved sanitation face less vulnerability to disease. And these are the specific objective of this study. Is to analyze the of access to safe drinking water in developed and developing countries, examine the effect of access to safe drinking water on different indicators such as health, education, the labor force participation rate. And this is the data source and the methodology. The study is based on the secondary data which is taken from the various source for the period of 2000 and 2015. At the way, 20 countries have been selected across the world with the higher and lower access to safe drinking water. And the data on the population with improved water coverage obtained from the World Development Indicators and the World Bank 2017 reports. And the education and health related data collected from HDI 2016 and Health Statistics Report 2017. Further analysis statistical tools such as the presentation, simple average, correlation, coefficient, etc. have been used. And as we can see, these are the results of this study. The first table is showing that the population coverage with improved water among the developed and developing countries. It presents the total as well as the rural urban population in selected countries with improved facilities over the period of 2000 and 2015. As table show that almost all the developed countries already achieved universal access to safe drinking water, that is 100% coverage. And table give an overview of the proportion of the population in the country that receive a good hygiene quality of the drinking water supply. But if we see on the other hand that developing countries are still not on the right track, as table showing that Afghanistan has the highest number of people in the world without access to safe drinking water. More than only 55.3% of the population receive the improved water facilities. In the context of India, the number of piped water supply system in rural area is rapidly increased. However, it should be noted that there are significant inequalities between the rich and poor and the needs to be addressed in moving forward. The second table is showing the data to the health, education and labor force participation in the developed countries. The data reveals that with the high coverage of improved water in the developed countries, these countries experience high life expectancy, that is 81.7 years, lower mortality rate, average 3.8 and 4.6% for infant and under 5 mortality respectively. When we see the labor force participation with the high coverage, developed countries have higher female labor force participation, average 57.3%, and then the developing countries. In case of the education, more than 90% average of the female getting secondary education in the developed countries. If we see on the other table, this is the health and same outcomes with the developing countries. The table showing that as compared to the developed countries, developing countries experience low coverage of the improved water services, that is 89%, which is very less as compared to the other countries. The life expectancy is average 70 years, high mortality rate average 30 and 35% for infant and under 5 respectively. In context of labor force participation and female education, developing countries having only average 44.57% female labor force participation and average only 40% females population is getting secondary education. If we see that with the whole analysis, we can see that the achievement of the developed economies in the indicator of health as well as education are very high as compared to the developing countries. This table is showing the correlation metrics, the relationship between the high coverage and other indicator. It shows that there is a negative correlation between high water coverage and mortality rate and the positive correlation with the female labor force participation and their secondary education. With the high coverage, females are getting more opportunities. At the end, the conclusion, the highest proportion of the population without improved water facilities still living in the mostly in the developing countries. These countries also have the lower rank in the terms of HDI and the value of living standards of life. Lack of safe drinking water leads not only to poor health and less education achievement, but it also affects the living standard of the people, the per person earning, the GDP growth and overall development of a particular economy. The life expectancy at birth, female labor force participation rate and the female population with at least secondary education are directly associated with the water coverage of total population. Whereas infant mortality rate and mortality rate under 5 years of the age are inversely related to the total population with the water coverage. So as the suggestions, we can say that government should more give more attention towards the rural areas as compared to the other. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Kuldeep Kaur. Now it is open for the question answer. I invite the respected co-chair and the participant if they have any questions to put forth.
Yeah. Oh,
yeah.
Pranav Kumar ji, you are... Please put on off
the,
your mic.
Please, anyone participants have any question?
How to...
No.
Hello. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Hello.
Kuldeep Kaur ji.
Ji, sir.
Hello.
Hello. Ji, sir.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, Dr. Jaspal Singh ji, you want to ask something?
Yeah.
Please, sir.
Kuldeep Kaur.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you stated correlation as a relationship. Please correct it. Correlation coefficient not providing the relationship between two variables. This is just association.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. You
Thank
never
you,
stated two variable as they are correlated, as they are related to each other. If you collect any two variable from any phenomena which are not interlinked to each other, and then you find the correlation coefficient, that may be possible, that's significant. That's just association, not any relation.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Please, you provide a good insights. But you may provide such indicators across state and within the nation. Yeah.
Okay.
This is
interesting.
Insights for us.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, now what Dr. Jaspal Singh has said very correctly, you be careful about using of correlation. It is just providing you the association. In fact, whether they are related to each other or not, it is going to make you some kind of figure, which is not being substantiated to make any argument in analysis of this kind.
Thank you, sir.
Regarding impact of water, obviously, safe drinking water is still a goal which we need to achieve in many rural areas, even in urban areas also.
Yes.
We do have the water, but safe drinking water is a larger concept which has many dimensions to be response on this issue.
Yes, sir.
First, we need a water first to drink.
Yes.
And most of the water bodies which we have created since the third 5-year plan are being shifted to provide water to urban areas. So at the cost of rural area, we have been enjoying in the urban area status. And second, you mentioned about the policy implication, government should do this or government should do that. Now we need to more focus on your implication on the societal aspect also, where how the society person like me or you can contribute in saving the water, recharging the water, putting the water back to the aquifer through the at a society level or this thing. That aspect in the future course of time you can add into your research.
Sure.
And nice to see your presentation.
Thank you.
Look forward to have more details in the near future.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. May I invite now the Shruti Mishra? I could see he or she is available. Shruti Mishra.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah. Good morning.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Please share your presentation on the farm efficiency of KVK.
Sir, is it visible?
Yeah, yeah. You put it on the full screen.
Yeah.
For you?
Now it's fine, sir.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Others are requested to.
So, good morning to all the panelists and attendees. Myself, Shruti Mishra, PhD scholar at JNKVV Jabalpur. And I'm here to present my paper on the topic Farm Efficiency of KVK Adopted Farmers in Central Narmada Valley of Madhya Pradesh, a DEA approach. So the study was undertaken with the objective, firstly, to examine the extent of technical, allocative, economical, and scale efficiency of KVK adopted and non-adopted farmers' farm unit. And secondly, to find out the factors affecting these level of farm efficiencies. The methodology adopted for the study was the Narsinghpur district was selected purposively, which lies under Central Narmada Valley agroclimatic zone, and 45 farmers primary sample was collected in each of the category of the farm units, and the data was collected through a well-designed questionnaire from the farmers. The data was analyzed using R software in benchmarking package, using data development analysis. So the technical efficiency score of the farm units was found using DEA linear programming formulation, and the economic efficiency score was calculated using the cost optimum divided by cost observed. The scale efficiency score was achieved through a ratio of economical efficiency to the total to the technical efficiency under VRS assumption, and allocative efficiency was obtained by dividing economic efficiency by the corresponding technical efficiency. And the linear regression was run to find out the factors affecting these level of So the major findings of the study was, firstly, the efficiency scores. So the efficiency scores was observed and estimated in both Kharif and Rabi season. For the adopted in Kharif season, for the adopted between adopted and non-adopted farmers, it was found significant. The significance was found out using two sample t-tests at 5% level of significance. So it was found out that adopted farmers under technical efficiency, under VRS and CRS assumption, was found to be more technical efficient than the non-adopted farmers. And rest of the efficiencies in the Kharif season were found to be non-significant. And there lies some level of non-efficiency under economic level. If in Rabi season, all the efficiencies were found to be non-significant. The non-adopted farmers are found to be more technically efficient in Rabi season as compared with the adopted farmers. And the adopted farmers are found to be more allocative efficient. That is, they are putting their budget under right allocation. And there lies some level of economic inefficiencies under both adopted and non-adopted farm units. The scale efficiency, the adopted farmers farm unit were found to be more scale efficient than the non-adopted farm units. If we talk of the factors that affect the level of these efficiencies, so there were both dummy variables and quantitative characters were taken under consideration, like adoption status, literacy, and area under cultivation, percentage of area under high yielding varieties, fertilizer quantity, labor to machine expense ratio, etc. And the model with the highest AIC value were taken into consideration, and the factors which are found to be significant are depicted here. Firstly, and are worked out for each level of efficiency. So firstly, the area under cultivation is found to have is significant, but are negatively associated with economic, allocative, and technical efficiency under VRS assumption. While the percent of area under high yielding variety are found to have significant and positive impact on the level of efficiency scores. The fertilizer quantity are found to be significant and have positive impact only on technical efficiency under CRS and VRS assumption, while labor to machine expense ratio are found to be significant, have positive efficient impact on technical and efficiency under CRS and VRS assumption. If we talk of Rabi season, so there lies very few factors that are affecting the level of farm efficiency. So percent of area under HYV and labor to machine expense ratio are found to be significant and have positive impact on economic efficiency and allocative efficiency. While there is an impact of literacy here also, and that too has positive impact. So literacy, by increasing the level of education, they better know the allocation of the resources or the limited constraints. And area under cultivation are surprisingly have negative, are significant like in the Rabi season, but have negative impact association under the allocative efficiency. So the conclusion for the present study is the farmers, there is found a very not much significant level between the adopted and non-adopted farmers farm unit efficiency scores in both the adopted and non-adopted farmers farm unit. And there lies some level of inefficiency in both the farm levels. And the major factors to be considered for improving are area need to be increased for high yielding variety. And there is a managerial constraint as area under cultivation is found to be negatively associated. And literacy is giving a positive impact. So literacy and the level of education should is having positive association. For my research work, I would like to thank my department and my co-authors. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Shruti Mishra, being in the time of our presentation. It is a farm efficiency of KVK affected farmers in the Central Narmada Valley of MP.
Yes.
Now it is open for question and answer.
Anyone from the participant? No. Shruti.
Yes, sir.
You provide three type of efficiency: economic, technical, and allocative.
Yes, sir.
And few factors of that efficiency. Yeah, I'm right.
Yes, sir.
But I am some surprised from your research, because most of your factors are factor of production, not factor of management. Efficiency related to your managerial skill, not related to your production function. Two type of efficiencies there. One is the efficiency in your production system, and another one is the rest of the part in your, like you, when you run a regression in your data, so we find some error term, especially divided into things. One is that variable which not included in the production system, and rest part is the inefficiency of the production system. But you provide factors of production, not factors of efficiency, like H by V seed improve your production. Yeah, improve your production, definitely. But if 5% they have using high-yielding variety, but with different quantity, that different quantity affect your efficiency level. Which one exactly or betterly use that set of variables? So better to choose those variables like education of the farmer, farm size, fragmentation of land, like other variables like how many number that person connected with the extensional activities, that type of set of variables are affect your efficiency level. This is a production variable of the production function. So please incorporate such variables.
Yes, I have included age, literacy, adoption status, and dummy variables. But yeah, only the literacy has a statistically significant impact.
This is because your production function not allows you running the efficiency function. Because you are sample, I think 45 farmers there.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, 45 farmer in there, and all farmers are from the Ban place, a Ban district, and the most of the play area you choose Ban district from the Madhya Pradesh, na?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that area of the Madhya Pradesh are homogeneous type. And the practice of the farmers are homogeneous. In such type of data, efficiency function not allow you to run the next stage of the efficiency. This is just production function. Rest fluctuations consider as a error of the production function, not as a inefficiency function. So
yes,
please be careful.
Okay, sir.
You present a good area, but be careful. Please
take a note, Shruti Mishraji, as sir has suggested you. And it was a nice presentation. Thank you. May I now invite Aman Gill? I think he is back. Mr. Aman Gill?
Yeah, Aman Gill.
Amandeep Singh.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Amandeep.
Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Amandeep, apni presentation share kar do. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Amandeep.
Yes, sir, I share you, please.
Next presentation will be Shekhar and Surendra Mehar. They please keep ready.
Yes, sir, we are ready.
So let us now, Aman Gill is going to share his screen.
So due to network issue, only sir 1 and 2 minutes, please wait, sir. Sir, please, you can call to next one. I will later.
I invite Mr. Shekhar and Surendra Mehar, NS 20071, on sustainable farmers participation and agriculture marketing system, a case study of UP.
Shekhar, good afternoon, sir. Yes, sir. Myself Shekhar.
Yeah, good afternoon.
So is my screen is visible? Hello?
Yes, visible.
Good afternoon, everybody. Myself Shekhar, department research scholar from Department of Economics, DBE University, Lucknow. Today I'm going to present a paper entitled Sustainable Farmer Participation in Agriculture Marketing System, a case study of Uttar Pradesh, co-authored by Dr. Surendra Verma, Assistant Professor, Department of Economics, BBE Lucknow. So first slide is about introduction. As we know, the development of the agriculture sector depends on many factors such as availability of inputs, infrastructure, transport, marketing, along with good governance. The role played by farmers in utilizing these inputs cannot be underestimated in the overall agriculture scenario. Thus, there is no dubiousness from the fact that the farmers are the genuine tillers of the land, and efforts and sacrifices upon their parts play a major role in shaping the policy draft into the reality. So, interest-linking policy making in most cases has revolved around the agrarian structure since India got independence. Despite these efforts, distress among farmers cannot be denied in Uttar Pradesh and other agriculture-dominated states. There are so many factors that determine farmers' distress in UP. Out of this, lack of infrastructure and agriculture marketing is the crucial one in the context of modern contemporary India. So, generally, farmers arrive at the market in the hope of fetching fair price of their agriculture produce, keeping in mind the perishable property of the produce, but lack of amenities and fair practices in this agrarian market sometimes not only discourage them, but also affect their earnings. Hence, the advancement of these basic amenities is an essential and prerequisite for sustaining a farmer's income. So, am I audible? Hello?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, sir. So the role played by Uttar Pradesh Krishi Utpadan Mandi Adhiniyam and State Agriculture Produce Marketing Board is crucial in restoring this facility and practices of fair practices in these markets. So the objective of this study is to evaluate the farmer participation in the agriculture market in terms of the infrastructure, services, and other amenities provided in the market communities. This is the sampling plan, and the methodology adopted by the paper is the primary data which was collected from participants who are the farmers of the agriculture marketing mandis in Uttar Pradesh. The Uttar Pradesh State Agriculture Produce Market Board classified the mandis into four categories, that is A plus, A, B, and C category. Therefore, 25 samples were selected from each of the pre-classified stratum from Lucknow mandi, that is A plus, Raebareli mandi, that belongs to A category, Unnao mandi, B category, and Lalganj mandi, C category. The total sample of 100 samples were collected from the above same mandi to examine farmer participation in the agriculture market and its impact on their socio-economic status. This is the first table, and this shows the status of religion and social categories among households. The table revealed that most of the participant farmers belong to the general categories, followed by OBCs. The proportion of SC farmers is relatively low. Further, the participation of Muslim OBCs has also seen to be the least. The next slide is showing the participants farmers of landholding size. This table depicts landholding size of all the farmers who were participating in all the four mandi during the survey. The table portrays high participation of the marginal farmers followed by small and medium farmers. This particular finding supports the evidence of intensifying marginalization in the rural economy. The third table shows the land cultivation intensity in the UP among the four mandis. The table depicts the intensity for cultivating the land holdings by farmers. Table shows that a significant proportion, that is almost 63% of the total participant farmers, cultivate their land holding twice a year, followed by thrice, 36%, while merely 1% was found engaging more than thrice in a year. In short, land cultivation intensity has stood high among the participant farmers because it is a scarce resource of earning livelihood, especially to the marginal and small farmers. This table shows the mandi-wise status of farmers' visit. The table 4 exhibits the status of visit of farmers in each mandi. The highest number of participants, that is 55%, has been seen as a regular visitor. It was followed by the participant farmers who are the frequent visitors, that is 43%, and at least participants have been found as irregular visitor, 2%. Thus, it can be said that physical contribution of the participant farmer in the mandi is satisfactory. This is the table showing the status of fees and charges levied on different social groups. I come to the finding of this table. The direct selling of the produce by the farmer in the Kisan Mandi comes under the Kisan Bazaar Yojana. So any charge levied upon the participant farmers come under the unauthorized category. The table reflects that the farmers belonging to general deny any such extraction, while contrary to it, farmers belong to OBC and SC admit that they have been charged about rupees 10 to 50 rupees, witnessed within Lucknow and Lalganj Mandi under the study. Thus, caste of the participant farmers have seemed to be playing a dynamic role in illegal extraction from the downtrodden and marginal farmers within these mandis, either due to their poor social status or bad social affiliation in mandi. This is the mandi-wise role of mediator. Table exhibits mandi-wise role of mediator in all four mandis. The table shows that a mediator or arathiyas play a dominant role of buyer in majority. This is the table showing the facilities which are provided by the mandis within the mandis, and the conclusion of this study is in overall A plus mandi have found better equipped in terms of amenities available inside the mandis. It was followed by A plus B, A, B and C category mandi respectively. Thus, the participant farmer arriving in A plus mandi have access to better amenities followed by A, B and C categorized mandi. Now the next table is mandi-wise assistance in immediate payment facility. It is the facility provided on the part of the mandi. This table shows that the result reveals that the majority of the participant farmers availing the benefit of immediate payment facility and getting timely payments. The next table is mandi-wise status of basic information provided to participant farmers. The result shows that most of the mandi lag behind in terms of basic information to improve the marketing activities of participant farmers. Consequently, profit margin on the sale of the farmer produced one more. This is slide shows the conclusion and suggestion. The present study evaluated the farmers' participation in agriculture marketing along with basic infrastructure and different services available to them in context of four mandis in Uttar Pradesh. With the help of primary data, the study revealed that most of the farmers belong to general category and OBC category, while SC counted relatively a lower proportion. This may be due to the fact that the majority of SC households belong to marginal farmers whose marketable surplus is quite low. Evidential from Singh 2011, Bura 2000, Jacharia's A 2011, Rawal's 2011. However, irrespective of social classes, the small and marginal farmers had been actively participating in all the formalities. The study revealed that a major chunk of farming households do not visit to the mandi frequently. Hence, the arrangement provided to these farmers for encouraging their arrivals in the mandi did play a significant role in terms of facility and awareness provided by the mandi committees. The study also reported illegal charges in the name of fees from the farmers that are being extracted from poor and downtrodden classes. Further, mediator play a dominant role in the prevalent marketing system. As far as provision of infrastructure and other services facilities concerned, the study noted that facilities such as rural, godown, telephone, canteen, grading of agriculture produce facility are not evenly available in all formalities. Some of the facilities such as shed and char are not relevant in the present day, where fund allocation should need to be reduced. Further, these mandis lags behind in terms of basic information to improve the marketing activities of participant farmers. Consequently, profit margin on the sale of farmers produced were low that need to be restored through awareness campaign. At last, the study overall concludes that participation of farmers in agriculture marketing, especially from bottom of social class and that of marginal farmers, is low, and there is scope for mandis to improve basic infrastructure and information services. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Shekhar.
Yes,
it is on the marketing system in Uttar Pradesh, where you have chosen the four type of mandis.
Yes, sir.
So I have a few questions, but I'll request others to ask first.
Yes, sir. Sure.
Any participant? Okay, I'll put the question. Dr. Shekhar, I have seen this now. Your study has gone through the four type of mandis in Uttar Pradesh.
Yes, sir.
Now, I could find some kind of mismatch in your findings and the selection of this thing. When you have gone through the selection, sampling plan, you have gone for A plus A, B and C. Which must be because on the basis of their transaction and audit reports, right?
Yes, sir. On the basis of their income earnings.
Yeah, yeah. So it was very surprised to see that all four mandis doesn't have a godowns, telephone, canteen, on these things, right?
But some of them have these facilities.
No, your last conclusion slide, if you go, you have made a mention there. Second thing which you mentioned about, because your data is from primary data,
yes,
so why you take a help of a literature which has been mentioned in your conclusion slide? Because other study may not have a same study area which you have mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
So in conclusion, there is no need to mention about any earlier studies like you have mentioned in your two conclusions.
Yeah, your whole conclusion on the behalf of other studies, not on the behalf of your own study.
No, no, sir. I'm supporting my conclusion with the studies.
No, you do not to support. You are an ideal sole person who is doing the research, and you can come with a different conclusion or the same conclusion. That won't matter, but your base of a conclusion is your own study.
Okay.
When you do the literature survey in the beginning, you can make a mention about that these are the conclusions which I found in review. Let me check with the our study area what is happening there.
Okay, sir.
That is why we go for hypothesis also. And second, have you came across the ENAM, any one of a mandi
ENAM is actually the study when it is completed, the ENAM is just started. So I do not.
Illegal charges you have made mention us. Can you elaborate a little bit further?
Yes, sir. In illegal charges, I already mentioned that the direct selling by the farmers come under the Kisan Bazaar Yojana. But some farmers are paying some amount to the at the time of their entry or at the time of their activities to the mandis. So basically, if they come to the illegal extraction, if the farmers do not need have to pay that money.
No, if it is mandi fee and charges are levied by the APMR Act of the state government as per the UP government.
But direct selling by farmers will not come under the, it's not permissible in the, within the mandi.
No, one,
there is no provision, such type of provision, anyone free to sell their produce in a APMC mandi. And no restrictions there.
Actually, they do not have knowledge whether they have to be pay or not. But
pay for what?
They pay for selling their produce by farmers itself.
No, they are standardized some fees. Fee for deloading, fee for cleaning, packing, baiting.
Yes, sir. This is from different from
type
that.
Of activities. They are homogeneous throughout the state because APMC under APMC Act, the state specifically put their own fee structure, not as a homogeneous throughout the nation.
But yes, sir,
within a state, there I think there are no discrimination in.
Yes, sir, I totally admit with what you have said, but the finding of this study is particular those mandis, especially these belongs to the backward area, that Unnao and Lal Kani mandi, they are the...
Unnao is not backward area.
But they have not proper information to those farmers who are coming in.
Okay.
Shekhar ji. Yes,
see, once the commodity enter inside the premises of APMC, okay, so that would be entered in the register and some nominal fee, as sir has mentioned, across the mandis in the state are been approved by the APMR Act of the state government. Now, if a commodity is sold outside the mandi, obviously the charges will not be levied upon the purchaser or the seller.
Yes, sir.
So you talked about, you are been saying that though the farmer has sold his commodity inside the mandi, not through the auction or not through the process which has been put under the Regulated Market Act, still
yeah, direct,
the, direct sale, so that fee was levied upon the person. That is what you are arguing, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, please check it. Please check it once.
Yes, sir. I will check it. Yeah.
Any further clarification is needed from the author of a paper, or should we move to the next? We thank you, Mr. Shekhar.
Okay, sir.
We invite the next Pranav Kumar Anand.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon.
Yeah. Please share your screen if you have the PPT.
Okay, sir. Wait, sir, just a minute. Hello, Rankur. Ek minute. Kahan se? Jaldi ho. कहाँ चला गया? शेयर कैसे कर स्क्रीन स्टार्ट ना क्या हो रहा है यहाँ से
Praveen, share your screen. Praveen.
हेलो
हाँ हाँ प्रवीण शेयर करिए स्क्रीन को अपने.
हेलो हेलो
यस यस प्रवीण कुछ इश्यू आ रहा है क्या?
Sir, we can call next presenter.
Yeah, Hemant, better to call next. Yeah, Praveen is left now.
Pelly Ronia.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah.
Please,
now please. Reconnecting. Yeah.
Call to next presenter.
Yeah, sir. On behalf of Delhi, I will. Sir, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah. Abuja, Anuradha, Devi.
Yeah, sir. Sir, on behalf of Delhi, I will be presenting. So, if I have please a technical problem, guide me so that I can show my screen to you also.
Yeah, you can share the screen. Do the F5.
Okay.
Open your PPT. Apply the F5 tab so that your full screens come. Then you share the screen. Share the screen option is there.
Okay. Share screen.
On the bottom of the this.
So is it visible?
Yes, yes. Double click.
Good afternoon, all, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, the topic of my presentation is study of technological efficiency of ginger processing in East Sikkim. I have studied this as a case study. So, with the introduction, we like to introduce, beside all the presentation, which is all the point which is mentioned in the introduction, the first thing I would like to introduce is that Sikkim, as we know, is one of the organic state which has been declared. Beside all that opportunity we had, but marketing facilities and other agricultural infrastructure facility are weak as compared to other states. So in this regard, the only option which is left with us to boost up the income of the farmer is the processing unit. So in this regard, we are taking up a study on the one of the important commercial crop, that is the ginger. So ginger in Sikkim is very good quality, pungency and all. So selling in the market as a raw form has a lost opportunity. So in this presentation, we have taken up three objectives. The first is to identify the various methods of ginger processing which is followed in East Sikkim. And the second objective is to study the cause and reason of the ginger processing. And lastly, to find out the constraint which is faced by the ginger processing. Sir, as of the time limit, I have considered only one method, that is the mechanical method, but we have many more methods which is followed conventionally and traditionally. So going to the mechanical method, let us go to the second objective, as to bring out the information and to study the objective, we followed the purposive method in where we have selected each district. As one of the district, we have four districts in East Sikkim, in the Sikkim state. So we selected one of the district purposely, that is East district, because this district has the second largest production of the ginger, as well as in terms of the areas too. And for the case study, to find out the processing unit, we have selected purposely two processing units. The first one is Sundar Sikkim Processing Unit, which is located in Marchak, and which was established in year 2015 by Mr. Cecil Kharka with the name Nature Ghee Processing. Another is the ginger processing unit, named as the Nature Ghee Processing Unit, which is in Mazidar itself in the same district, which was started by the Mr. Vivek Sundari in the year 2014. This is the analytical tool. I don't think I should go for the detail, but it's very simple. So, break-even point was studied. And for the problem estimation, a simple tabular and the functional analysis has been followed. And for the technical efficiency, all that economic efficiency, which we have discussion, which is met on the previous slide, is a little bit different from mine. In this technical efficiency, we consider the actual output from the given input at the given level of the capacity utilization, which is divided by the maximum potential output from the given input at the full capacity utilization. And it is expressed in terms of the monetary value. So this is very less, but the